Oh, Lord, help me here. Lord, don't let me get too political. There are people today that are willing, almost willing, to make the president king if they think that he's going to be able to supply all of their needs. In other words, if he's going to be able to put bread on their table, as Bishop says, no one man can perform a miracle. Not a natural man. Not one single man is going to be the solution to our problem. Isn't it interesting that all the bad things happen, they blame on one man? And then they turn around and say all the good things that happened is because of the wonderfulness of this one man. But they were willing to make him a king based on the fact that he had fed them when they were hungry. You ever heard this terminology that people follow the Lord only for the loaves and the fishes? Which is really saying what? They follow the Lord only for the benefits that they can get in the natural. Well, I thank God that God is a supplier of all of our needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. I thank God that he can do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we ask or think according to the power that works within us. If God is able to feed the sparrows of the air and to clothe the lilies of the field, how much more is he concerned about us? So we can trust God, can we not? We can trust God for our daily bread. Give us this day our daily bread. But I'm not serving God because he gives me good things, and I thank God that he does. I guess I probably gave my heart to the Lord Jesus Christ in the beginning because I didn't want to go to hell. But that's not the reason I continue to serve him. I serve him is because I have a relationship with him. I seek to do that which is pleasing to him, not because I think he's going to be angry with me, but I do seek to do those things that bring glory and honor to him. Okay, where are we here? Okay, Lord, give us this bread. Okay, let's see.
Oh, we should be walking on the water.
We walk on. We already passed the bread, haven't we?
John 6:16-21.
Where did my walking on the water go? Okay, here we go.
John 6:16-21.
Okay, yeah. After the feeding of the 5,000 and the attempt to make him king, Jesus slipped to the hills alone. Then Jesus sends the disciples on ahead of him. The disciples set sail. The wind got up. Jesus comes walking on the water. One miracle after another. Peter says, Lord, if it's you, bid me to come. We're quick to criticize Peter, are we not? What do we criticize Peter for?
Faith.
Yeah, we say, well, Peter didn't have faith. Folks, Peter had to have faith or he never would have gotten out of that boat.
That's right.
Okay? He's the only one that we have any record of that got out of the boat. But we're quick to point out, well, he lost faith. No, one thing you say about Peter is that he kept things interesting, did he not?
I think so.
He was always willing to take a risk. He was always willing to stick his neck out. Now, listen to this. I don't know whether you ever thought about it or not, but here's Jesus. I don't know how far Peter walked.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how far Jesus was from the boat. But here comes Peter. He gets out of the boat and he walks on the water toward the Lord Jesus Christ. He looks down, becomes fearful, and he begins to sink. Well, I wonder how he got back to the boat. Did he walk on the water back to the boat?
He must have.
Or did Jesus carry him?
Swim.
Never think about that, do we? But he made it back to the boat, did he not?
Did you know?
Hmm?
Did you know how?
No, I don't.
So what does this sinking symbolize then?
What was sinking? Well, I think that you can draw a truth there that when you allow doubt to come in, that you will begin to sink. In other words, when you're walking on the water, what are you doing? You're overcoming your obstacles. What is the obstacle? The obstacle is the water that if you sink, if you can't swim, you're going to drown, right? So sinking there would just simply mean that you no longer are functioning under the power of the supernatural, which was brought about by the faith that he had to believe that when Jesus bid him to come, he got out of the boat, he walked on the water. But then you could say, well, you know, doubt creeped in. But it's interesting that our focus, you know, just like Bishop was preaching on Jonah, that we're quick to talk about, you know, Jonah's failure. But then when you really look at it from a different perspective, you understand that that story is much more powerful than we have even given it credit for. Okay. Jesus said, labor not for the meat which perisheth, but for the meat which endureth unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you, for him hath God the Father sealed. What shall we do to do the works of God? This is the work of God, believe on him whom he has sent. Now we talk about works. This, I think, brings up as clear as you can make it. What are the works of God? What works are we involved in? What is it that's going to bring us reward? It's not going to be our works, right? It's going to be to do what? The works of God. And what are the works of God? To believe. These are the works of God, that you believe on him whom he has sent. What signs showest thou then that we may see and believe thee? What dost thou work? Our fathers did eat manna in the desert. He gave them bread from heaven to eat. Jesus says, Moses gave you not that bread from heaven, but my Father giveth you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he which cometh down from heaven and giveth life unto the world. And the disciples said, Lord, give us this bread. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst. For I came down from heaven not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me. And this is the Father's will which hath sent me, that of all which he hath given me I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again at the last day. And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up the last day. No man can come to me except the Father which hath sent me draw him, and I will raise him up at the last day. Okay. I think that that's pretty much going to cover what we need to cover. One more scripture. I think this is John 6:63. Yeah. It is the Spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Jesus said, no man can come to me except the Father. Let's see, no man can come unto me except it were given unto him of my Father. And there are people who interpret this as meaning that there's only going to be so many that the Father's going to draw. I believe the invitation is out there for everybody. And you say, well, who's the Father going to draw? Well, he's going to draw those who believe and those who have faith. I mean, you can hear the gospel. The gospel is not going to benefit you until you take hold of it and you believe it. I don't believe that God created anyone to come to this earth to be doomed for eternal damnation. God didn't put you on the earth for that purpose. The Puritans did not know whether they were called of God or not. Well, I called upon the name of the Lord once upon a time. I was just a young teenager. But I called upon the name of the Lord, and He heard me. He came in. He made His abode within me. And that's been 1953. How long has that been? 59 years. And I have yet... I'm not to say that I've never made a mistake. That'd be stupid. But I've never yet turned my back on the Lord by the grace of God. I've never turned my back on God. Father, I love You. I thank You. I praise You. I thank You for the reality that You are to us, that You have come to give us life and give it to us more abundantly. I just pray in the name of Jesus that You will seal Your word in our hearts, our spirits, our lives, in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Go take a few minutes break, 10-minute break, and we'll come back for second class.